Thank you, Jan. Thank you. We had a good time, restful and busy all at the same time, and a lot of laughs, and so it was just good to be away for a while. Amen.
Amen.
And God is good. And likewise, we miss you too. And we're always thinking, even though there was a time change, we kind of say they're doing this at this time and they're doing that at that time. But our time schedule was a little off from your time schedule. Some things I was thinking you were doing, but you were gone. But we did think of you fondly doing. But we thank God for you and everybody that was in place to do what was needed to be done. And so we're so grateful for this house and even those that traveled with us, and that God kept us safe and sound, and the flights were good and passage was good. So and the enemy tried to rise up every day with little stuff to try to distract you, like leaving a cord somewhere behind or dropping something that was important and stuff. So we just kept rebuking. And you know, that's the way it is. But you have to understand that God wants us to enjoy and have rest too.
Amen.
Amen. And the enemy does not. And even when he sees it in place for you, he still will try to stop you from enjoying and having it. Amen.
Amen.
But you have to pursue in the promises of God over your life and what God said you could have. And I'll have that and nothing else. Amen.
Amen.
And so we just thank the Lord. He is good to us and he's a keeper. And again, we love you all so much and we praise God for you. We thank you. I was just thinking about the church and some of the things we set to do out in our leadership meeting. And so far this year, we've done everything that we had on the calendar to do at the time that we need to do. And so we're just moving ahead. Amen.
Amen.
And so God is gracious and he's good. And if you keep trusting him, the half has not been told. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's receive special music at this time and we go forward.
His eye is on the sparrow.
I sing because I'm free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches.
I know.
The Lord. That was my grandmother's song. I love that song. All right, now everybody grab your Bibles, please. Can you hear me okay? Okay. This is my Bible. I am what it says I am. This book calls me an overcomer. So that's who I am. Today I shall be taught the infallible, unchanging word of God. So my mind is alert, my heart is receptive, and I gladly receive the word today. I believe that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Amen. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just come to you humbly, Lord, thanking you for this day, oh God. Lord, have your way. Give them you and not me, Lord. Quiet my spirit, God. let this word that you placed in me fall on good ground, Lord. Now there is no fear, but there is perfect love. Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. In Jesus' name, amen. The title of my message is The Consummation of Love. Many times when we hear the word consummate or consummation, we think of marriage. In many traditions and statuses and statutes of civil or religious law, the consummation of a marriage, often simply called consummation, is the first officially credited act of sexual intercourse between two people following their marriage. During the time of kings and queens, this word was frequently used when referring to the marital chamber. Back then, when a king married his bride, the biggest concern of the royal court was if the marriage was consummated. A religious marriage without civil registration may or may not be legally binding, and such a marriage, regardless of the reason for non-consummation, can be dissolved by the Pope. Additionally, an inability or an intentional refusal to consummate the marriage is probable grounds for an annulment. Henry VIII, and I know you all know who Henry VIII is, he married his brother's wife, his brother's was Arthur, because Catherine of Aragon swore the marriage had not been consummated. The couple, Arthur and Catherine, married at age 12 and 13, and they lived together for a few months at Ludlow before Arthur's sudden death from an illness in 1502. What does the term consummate mean? It's just not relegated to marriage. The Merriam-Webster Dictionary defines consummate as a verb, to finish, complete, consummate a business deal. For example, the bargaining process went on for a few days, but the deal was never consummated. Regarding marriage, it means to make a marital union complete by sexual intercourse. For example, their happiness was not consummated until their son was born. In the Webster's Dictionary of 1828, consummation means completion in perfection of a word, process, or scheme. Consummation of marriage, the most intimate union of the sexes, which completes the connubial relation. Connubial, pertaining to marriage, means nuptial, belonging to the state of husband and wife, as connubial rights, connubial love. The word consummate can also be found in the Bible as well. Genesis 29, verse 21, says that Jacob said to Laban, "Give me my wife. I've completed what we agreed. I've completed what we agreed I do. I'm ready to consummate my marriage." Matthew 1, 24 through 25, Message Bible still. Then Joseph woke up. He did exactly what God's angels commanded in the dream. He married Mary, but he did not consummate the marriage until she had the baby. He named the baby Jesus. Romans 5, 9 through 11, and this is Message as well. Now that we are set right with God by means of the sacrificial death, consummate blood sacrifice, there is no longer a question of being at odds with God in any way. If when we were at our worst, we were put on friendly terms with God by the sacrificial death of his son, now that we're at best, just think of how our lives will expand and deepen by means of his resurrection life. In these various scriptures, you recognize a common theme. The theme is about relationships. There was a business relationship, a marital relationship, and a sacrificial relationship where Jesus paid the price with his blood for our sins. In Genesis 29, Jacob spoke of completing the business deal he made with his uncle Laban and was ready to consummate his marital relation with his wife as promised, even though he thought he was getting Rachel, but he got Leah first, so I don't think he was that good of a businessman. Okay? In Matthew, Joseph valued his relation with God and through obedience honored God and did not consummate the marriage until she gave birth to Jesus. He loved Mary, but he loved God even more. It is evident because he demonstrated restraint. Romans 5 and 5, and this is New King James Version. Now hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. We know that the hope of great future blessings will not turn out to be false, because the Holy Spirit gives lavish evidence in our hearts of God's love for us. So what type of love are we talking about? This type of love is known as agape. Agape denotes an undefeatable benevolence and unconquerable goodwill that always seeks the highest good of other persons, no matter what he does. It is the self-giving love that gives freely without asking for anything in return and does not consider the worth of its object. Agape is more of a love by choice than philos, which is a love by chance. It refers to the will rather than the emotion. Agape describes the unconditional love God has for the world. John 3:16 tells us, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." There should be no doubt in our minds on how much God loves us. But what does the Bible say about how we are to love? Matthew 22:37-39. New King James. You should love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You should love your neighbor as yourself. Now, that sounds real good on paper. It's real good. But do we really practice it? Do we really put it into action? Think about it for a minute. Do we really love others like ourselves? Better yet, I dare say, do we love others like God loves us? Here are a few challenges that we face when it comes to loving others. I want you to think about your day-to-day activities, about the people you encounter throughout your day. The Bible tells us that people are lovers of themselves, and we see that frequently. We see it so much today, it's unbelievable. Their first concern is only them. Only them. You know that person who cuts you off in traffic? They are focused on getting to their destination no matter what. Strange thing happened today. I hear pastors sometimes saying, if you look around long enough, there's so much stuff you can minister on or talk about and you can use in your actual message. Well, we're driving to work, to church today. See that? I'm thinking work. And this lady is flying down Davidson in this white cruise. I didn't even know it was a lady at first. She was booking, you hear me? She came from the far right lane to the far left lane. And you're thinking she's going to get in the lodge, right? She kept going. This other car was coming over, right over to merge over to go on the lodge. It could have been an accident. The car swerved just like this. It was like that close. That woman was only thinking about herself. She didn't know that she was about to create an accident. I mean, we saw it. We literally saw it. And when we got to the light after coming off the Davidson, she was sitting right there in the far right lane. And I was like, all that? Really? And then she waited for the light to turn, to change the green, and she made a right turn and booked on down Rosa Parks. But, you know, that's what people do. They only think about themselves. To take it even further, you know that coworker that never seems to complete his or her task on time, you know. Their inability to complete the task holds up the entire project and creates an animosity between teammates, you know. Why I got to do it, you know? And meanwhile, they didn't carry out their task, you know. It works your last nerve, and I know these things are not earth-shattering, But it's a challenge, though. You still got to love them, you know. But I have my own personal experiences to share. I was in a furniture store, and I can say the name. It was Gardner White. And I'm talking with a sales associate about buying furniture. We're really trying to work it out. I want this, want that, you know. How, will it fit? You know, everything. This lady just walks up and doesn't say, excuse me. She just started talking. She didn't say, dog, could you move over? She didn't do nothing. She was like, she just started talking. And I was like, okay, help me, Lord. Yeah. I thank God every day for delivering me from some things. Because a lot of you all know, I say 20, 25 years ago, she would have got it. Look, oh, door 10, that ain't right. No. God has been working on me. He's been working on me a lot, you know. So, but I handled like a seasoned professional. And she got the message loud and clear. But it gets better. How about that undercover security guard that follows you through the store, the department store, just to make sure you're not stealing anything? And even after that, after you make your purchase, and you have to register, and you pay for your merchandise and everything, you give the cashier the money, and she gives you your change on the counter. No. That's a good one. I'm talking about loving others like you love yourself. Remember, I know we all suffer from a slight case, not all of us, of road rage, but we can, we might have told that person driving like a bat out of heck a few colorful adjectives, but we know we can do better than that. Or you might tell that coworker where to go, but we cannot react that way. Remember, agape love is love by choice and not by emotion. Pull yourself together. You may have to take a step back and think about the situation before responding. And this is how we learn to fight like a Christian. Jesus tells us in Luke 17 that it's impossible for offenses not to come, because they will. You know they're going to come. They're going to come. And in verses 3 and 4, he tells us, take heed to yourselves. If your brother sins against you, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him. And if he sins against you 7 times in a day, and 7 times in a day returns to you saying, I repent, you shall forgive him. I can hear somebody saying, you know, you just getting a little bit old. You need to work this out. It's something you need to get together. You keep doing this over and over and over and over and over again. But you still got to forgive him. And I know we all been hurt one time or another, and many of us lash out because we are hurt. But God has given us the ability to forgive. It is by his grace that we are able to overcome situations. I can remember my first time going to Presence at Covenant Church in Pittsburgh. It was a wonderful time, might I add. Every morning there was prayer, praise and worship, and then there was a guest speaker or two who would speak that morning. In the early afternoon, there were breakout sessions, and I believe Rose went with me. I don't know if Sherry was there. Sherry hadn't gone yet, but it was me and Rose. And we attended some type of prophetic prayer session. You know, first of all, the ministers, I didn't know that they were going to see people individually. You know, you think with that kind of thing. I'm like, come on now. Really? I'm like, okay, do I really want to do this? Will's laying back in the cut because he's not going to do it at all. He's just, I'm not doing this. So he didn't do it. So, you know, I waited for my turn, and next thing you know, it's my turn. The minute I got in the room, I sat down. I'm going to step back from the mic for a minute. The man said, this gentleman, I'm sorry. Do you accept my apology? I'm sorry. I'm looking at him like, hold up, brother. I don't know you. Who are you? I'm looking at him like, what? He went on to say, I'm sorry for all those things, people who hurt you. I don't know why they did what they did, but I'm so sorry. Do you accept my apology? Man, after that, that was it. That was enough. It was said and done. I was in tears because I knew only God knew how I felt on the inside. It was like a burden had been lifted from my heart and my spirit. In the natural, I never mentioned it to anyone because I thought that in this life, people will hurt you and things just happen. If you live long enough, you will find that experience is the best teacher. Life is what you make it. If we allow things from our past that once caused us great sorrow to fester, we will never get to experience all that God has for us. I do know that forgiveness is necessary, even if you never receive an apology from those persons who hurt you. I had to learn to let go. In this life, you must forgive everyone and let go of all that hurt in order to move forward, or it can destroy you. You may ask yourself, how can we accomplish this? I need to hold on. I'll take a drink of water here. Thank you, Rose. You may ask yourself, how can we accomplish this? First, you got to love one another. Love your brothers and sisters in Christ. Know that both love and righteousness are evidence of your salvation. 1 John 4:11-13, New King James Version says, "Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love has been perfected in us." Verse 13, "By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us his spirit." Yes. Yes. Although God is invisible, we manifest his nature through lifestyles that reflect his love. The spirit does not indwell us because of our love, but on the contrary, He enables us to love. That is how we are able to forgive one another and move on. The consummation of love, that's number two. We are made complete when we become one with God. We were created in his image, and he has breathed his spirit into us. This union of the Holy Spirit and our spirit enables us to love. 1 John 4:17-21, New King James Version, "Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fear has not been made perfect in love." Verse 19, "We love him because he first loved us." If someone says, "I love you, God," and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he does not love his brother whom he has seen. How can he love God whom he has not seen? 21, "And this commandment we have from him, that he who loves God must love his brother also." Amen. Truth. John speaks strongly about living godly lives. He clearly teaches that our knowledge and love of God will be evident by our obedience to his word and love for our brothers and sisters in Christ. We are not simply to talk about love, but to love practically by giving to and caring for those in need. I also believe that we have to take it a step further. It's easy to love those in the body of Christ for the most part. Dora and I were talking about that this morning. Things always come up. You know, we may make somebody upset and we don't mean to, not intentionally, I hope we don't. But we always come back. We know we love them. We know we love them. And so it is what it is, but it's so easy to love everybody in the body of Christ, but what's the really a bigger challenge is that we also have to love those outside the body. Simply put, if we know and love Jesus, then we are to live and love as he did. I told you, everything happens for a reason. I'm not going to go into all the details, but sister was challenged this week, and I had to show love, real love, and restraint. But I made it through. Thank you, God. We need to pray and intercede on behalf of Christians you see participating in sin. You know, pray that they would turn from their sin and that God would give them life. Instead of talking about them, gossiping about them, pray for them. That's the best thing you can do. Because that means we just like everybody else, saying what happened. It's not good. We got to pray for them. Understand that obedience is the clear mark of a person who knows God. Obey God's word so that his love will mature in you. We are called to live holy lives, set apart to live and love as Jesus did. Because God is love, he calls us to express that love in our relationship with others. Therefore, we are not to hate our brothers and sisters in Christ, nor the ones on the outside either. Forgive offenses quickly so that your hurt and anger do not turn into bitterness and hatred. When you hold on to stuff, it makes you sick. It brings on disease. People don't think it, but it does. It really does, and you just got to learn to let it go. And it's just not a phrase, let go and let God. It's for real. It's the truth. Do not believe the lie that the world has much to offer. It offers only lust and pride. And, you know, although we're not of this world, we got to be realistic. We live in it. We see stuff day to day. We cannot be ignorant to what's going on around us. People are treating others horribly simply because of the color of their skin or where they came from. We have people in leadership who are preaching hate. We have people in the government. And you know, it's just ridiculous. Yet we still have to love them and pray for them continuously. So Dora, cut off CNN. Because it'll drive you crazy. Sometimes turn on a cartoon. Watch Dora, the Explorer. Remember that all authority is ordained by God, good or bad. It is what it is. This is what we got. This is what we got. Sometimes I want to go to work and say, did y'all really do this? Yeah, sure. This what y'all want. That's what I want to tell them sometimes, but you know, it is what it is, and despite what is going on, we have to trust God and know that we are covered with the blood of Jesus. Do not be blinded by the darkness of hatred. Understand it will cause you to fall in. It will cause you to fall in your walk with the Lord. Turn away from hatred. Ask for forgiveness for any hate you have in your heart. Ask God to heal you and enable you to forgive, knowing that Jesus paid the price for the wrong people have done. By no means is it easy, but we must continually reach out to God and ask him for strength and understanding. Trust God and lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. You have to stand on the word of God, even when you don't see a way out. You got to fight like your life depends on it. But you got to remember, we got to love. We got to love no matter what. Remember, he has placed the Holy Spirit in us and has given us the ability to love. Blessings to you.
The outworking of loving and forgiving, and while she was saying so many things about the first thing that hit me is how when you love God you need to exercise constraint, And that's what Joseph did. He obeyed God for what God had told him. And so, but as a husband to be, and he probably said, I have rights too. But I'm going to use a word that was okay long before our president came in, and that there's something that trumps your rights.
Yes.
And that's God.
Yes.
And so he exercised restraint, and the promise was able to come through.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And so I was just thinking about loving and forgiving when Helene said that about restraints and all those things. I want to be clear that we share that forgiving does not mean forgetting.
Amen.
Because people down through time have said forgive and forget, but it's almost impossible to forget. I fell and hurt my knee once, and it hurt at that time. It hurt, it burst open, and I didn't get stitches on it, so there is a scar. But over time, it doesn't hurt anymore, but the scar is still there. The scar is that place that you don't forget, but it doesn't rise up to hurt you anymore. And that's what happened when we release stuff. It doesn't rise up to hurt us anymore. And it takes a little time to release. It takes time to love people. Especially, it's hard when people are needy and rude. They need you, but they ready to jump you. Because they need you how they need you. They don't know that everything is a requirement. Because they want to bystep everything. I don't need to give you any information. I don't need to tell you what the real situation is. Just do it because I said I need it. How many know God doesn't even operate that way? But we still have to love them and still have to honor them. I know about the situation that Helene was talking about. And I said, the best recourse is always just to stay polite, keep honoring them, keep doing what you need to do, and keep it moving. Because sometimes stuff happens like that to rattle your love, to see where you're at. And you just have to go above it, because there's some people designed to test your love. They designed to test it. They know how to get under your skin, especially in our family. But at the same time, you still have to show love. But sometimes I believe you need to show tough love too. I love you, but I'm not going to. Amen. And they don't understand it right away, but they get it later. Amen. My hardest teachers were the one I remember the most. Won't let me slide. I don't even know their name now. But that one that sent me through. And even though I won't admit it always, they made me better. Your challenges make you better. They make you better. So thank you, Minister Helene, for talking about the consummation of love. And we are in a consummated relationship with the Lord.
Yes, we are.
We're in a consummated relationship. And God loves us so much until when we go to receive a private word of prophecy, He'll just step down in our stuff and say, forgive me. Forgive me. See, in the flesh, we want to say, what you talking about? But in your spirit, your heart starts saying, oh, Lord, something happening here. And that's what happened to you. Then you realize that the Lord knows all those places where we haven't let go of stuff. He knows. He knows where we hurt. And His love helps find it and soothes us. How many are glad that God knows? He really knows. And we're grateful for that knowing. Amen. All over the room, lift up hands and thank the Lord for loving you. And and for living in a consummated relationship with the Lord. Hallelujah. We're in an intimate relationship with you, and we know you today, God. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. In Jesus' name. I don't know where this comes from. Let it go. Let it go.